Hi, students. This video is about 20th century art because Viktor Frankl, this is part of the wrap up to Unit 3, How Do We Cope with Evil and Suffering? Viktor Frankl was writing in the 20th century, and just as we've discussed the art of the Enlightenment and the art of romanticism, I want to say a few words about 20th century art and how artists of the 20th century were grappling with ways to respond to a lot of the chaos of the 20th century, which Viktor Frankl was also grappling with. So I wanted to talk a little bit about what 20th century art was like and what the concerns of 20th century artists were. And then I want to encourage you, you are actually required this week to watch a video that gives more detail about 20th century art and read a short article about modern art. Okay, so the big theme with 20th century art is this idea of breaking with tradition. And I wanted to relate it a little bit to Frankl. In Man's Search for Meaning on page 129, Frankl writes, "Every age has its own collective neurosis, and every age needs its own psychotherapy to cope with it. The existential vacuum, which is the mass neurosis of the present time, can be described as a private and personal form of nihilism." So just as every age needs its own psychotherapy to cope with the collective neurosis, every age also needs its own art to cope with that neurosis. And if the neurosis of the Enlightenment age was the need to break free from feudalism and the authoritarian rule of the monarchy, and to do so by pursuing knowledge and spreading knowledge, then maybe the neurosis of the Romantic period was to rebel against this worship of science and question whether, you know, scientific advances were always positive. We talked about how artists of that time were very alarmed about the railroads. Obviously in Frankenstein, we saw how Shelley questions whether all knowledge is good and all knowledge is really for the best. Just as Viktor Frankenstein comes to, you know, to wonder the same thing. So in the 20th century, we're dealing with two world wars that brought incredible horrors to Europe and much of the rest of the world. Artists and thinkers were all trying to grapple with that. So we've been reading Frankl the last few weeks, and I think all of you have a really good sense of how he chose to respond. But what I want to sort of touch on now is how artists chose to respond. So he says that the existential vacuum, which is the mass neurosis of the present time, can best be described as a private and personal form of nihilism. So nihilism is a little bit, it's pretty negative. It's like saying there's a nothingness. We have to face our nothingness, and that there's no real meaning, or which is how it seems, right? When 6 million Jews are killed, or when then there's the Armenian genocide, or when there's a world war that kills millions of people, there's a sense of meaningless. What is the point? There's no order. And artists were grappling with that, just as Frankl was. So how did artists respond? And the best answer to that question, excuse me, is they responded in a lot of different ways and with a lot of different artistic movements. We're not going to talk about all of these in this slideshow. I think maybe in the video, the art historian who talks in that video does touch on all of these. But some of the biggest, most important movements were Fauvism, German Expressionism, Cubism, Surrealism, Abstract Expressionism, and Futurism. And though these movements were really different from each other, they shared some key features and concerns. The first one, it was a sense of fragmentation, a sense that cultural traditions and norms were breaking up. And you really feel this in the sections of Frankl's book where he talks about logotherapy. He talks about how young people don't have a sense of meaning. They aren't rooted in a culture anymore. They're not rooted in a religious tradition anymore. And he sees that as a source of a lot of problems. Artists were seeing that too, that they were not interested so much in following tradition because they saw that traditions were sort of falling apart in some way. Also very important to visual art, there was a sense that with the arrival of photography, visual art had to move beyond realism. So if somebody can come along with a camera and take a picture and thereby perfectly reproduce a picture of a river or, the Eiffel Tower, then artists started to think, well, why should I work so hard to make this perfect representation of the Eiffel Tower if a photograph can already do that? So what can art do? What can painting do? What can sculpture do that will be different from that and will add something different besides just reproducing reality? And then, of course, a lot of 20th century art was a response to the chaos of the two world wars. Some of these responses were seen as optimistic and some of them were seen as very pessimistic. Fauvism, just want to check one thing here. I need to go back and I'm not sure I know how to do that. The Fauvists were not interested in making reproductions of reality, but in recreating what they saw to convey their feelings about it. Henri Matisse said, "Only the colors on my canvas can render the emotions of that landscape." So here's an example of one of Matisse's paintings, The Joy of Life. As you can see, it's not realistic, but you can see it also creates a feeling, these really warm colors. You get this sense of, you know, it's almost like paradise. It's beautiful. The colors are really inviting. So he wasn't trying to copy what he saw in front of him. He was trying to recreate it in a new way, using colors that conveyed his feelings about it. Ernst Ludwig Kirchner's Fauvist works were very different in tone. He did a lot of Fauvist works that were like, it's kind of hard to see in this picture, but these are people in the city and there's a person in the middle who's sort of covering their head. And it's a real picture of solitude in the midst of a crowd. So not so warm and positive as Matisse. He was creating feeling with his choice of colors, but a very different tone. And that is, this is called Street Dresden by Ernst Ludwig Kirchner. Cubism also rejected outside forms and representations. It also said, we're going to do something different from just copying what we see. And it's a little hard to see, cubism can be really challenging as a viewer. But in cubist works, artists often represented forms from different angles. So this is Woman with Mandolin by Pablo Picasso. And in This picture, you actually get different perspectives on the mandolin on this flat surface. So Picasso and other cubists were sort of experimenting. Well, I've only got a flat surface, but that doesn't mean I can't show more than one perspective. So again, artists were thinking about, what can I do that's different from what photography does? How can I play with the whole idea of a flat surface representing a three-dimensional reality? German expressionist, and this is a quote from the video, transformed reality into a mood. They didn't compete with the camera, but transformed reality into a mood. So this is Blue Rider by Wassily Kandinsky. Again, not realistic. He's playing around with color and with creating a mood with that color. And then there was abstract art. You may have seen Jackson Pollock paintings before. They are just these wild, arrangements of paint on canvas, no interest in representing anything but the paint itself. So abstract art turned away from reality completely. Some saw this as a desire to escape reality. I don't want to be in the world. I just want to, splatter paint on canvas. Others saw it as a way to look for new meaning. Well, maybe I just spread white and black paint and all these other colors on canvas because I think it's beautiful and I'm looking for a new kind of aesthetic. Isn't it just beautiful to see the way paint can be arranged on canvas? So Pollock was really experimenting with splattering this paint on canvas and seeing it and thinking about art in a new way. This is one, number 31 by Jackson Pollock. And then I'm gonna let you watch the video on 20th century art, which goes into detail about all these movements. But I also am always struck by how this idea of fragmentation kind of has spread through our culture. And it's a really different way of looking at the world and the human experience from the way we looked at the world and human experience, say, before 1850, when many of us lived in villages and grew up, following a religious tradition and a particular culture, and we were very rooted in that culture. In the 20th century, we know people were moving into cities, the world wars were happening, and many of us were not so rooted anymore. So as I said earlier, there's this idea of fragmentation. And I'm always struck when I hear this song. This is a song by performed by Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong, and who are, by the way, they made a few CDs together and they're phenomenal. I highly recommend you listen to them. But I also am struck every time I hear this song about, by the way, it evokes fragmentation and the way artists and thinkers in the 20th century we're dealing with it. So I'm just going to play you the beginning of this song. You can play the whole thing if you want to go into the slideshow. And then I'm just going to say a couple things about it.
The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. No, no, they can't take that away from me. The way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. No, no, can't take that away from me. We may never, never meet again on the bumpy road to love. Still I'll always, always keep the memory of the way you hold your knife, the way we dance till three, the way you've changed.
The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. No, no, you can't take that away from me. The way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. No, no, you can't take that away from me.
All right, I'm going to stop there. I could listen to that all day. I love those two. But it's just, I love that song. I mean, I love the song anyway, but I think it's also really emblematic of the 20th century, because these lovers are saying to each other, you know, we're over and it didn't work out, it fell apart, but I'll always have these memories, the way you sip your tea, the way you sing off key. And that's a perfect expression of this idea of fragmentation, that in this world where we can't have maybe anymore the, you know, where we don't know when chaos is going to erupt, we're in the middle of world wars, or we're in the middle of the Holocaust, or we're in the middle of industrialization. But what we have are these small things that we can appreciate and cherish in a world where maybe we don't feel like we can count on certain other things being orderly. So I always am struck by the expression of fragmentation in that song. All right, so I just wanted to touch on those aspects of 20th century art. And like I said, go ahead and watch the video about 20th century art, read the article, and then I'm gonna give you a prompt to discuss 20th century art as it relates to Frankl, a discussion prompt for that. So you should post in that after you've checked out those other resources. I don't mean to click on that. Yeah, you can learn about more about 20th century art in the following pages. All right. If I can find out how to turn this off. There it goes.